All right. Listen up and listen good. This is Schmitty with the podcast Talkin Schmit. Last week we had Evan Smith. I'm Greg Smith, and today on the show is Freddie Smith the third. But before we get started, let's pump up the holiday cheer with a new holiday jam from the Trujillos, Bad Shit's latest Christmas song. This is a Donner Party Christmas. If you like that shit, check out the Bad Shit page at Bandcamp. I will put a link below in the text. Hey, it's winter time, and that means hunkering down in the cold and watching some TV, documentaries, movies, whatever. What are you guys watching? You know, what's some of the good shit you're checking out? Email me. Come on. I'd love to hear from you. You guys hear from me every fucking week. The least you could do is let me hear from you once in a while, huh? TalkinSchmit@gmail.com. Also, big shout out to Eric at Classic Skate Shop.
Shout out.
Dude, thank you so much. You know for what, and I appreciate you big time. That was insane. What's Honeybee barking about? Are the rumors true of a few Eastern exposure legends getting together to drop a new company? She says it's going to be called Underachievers. Only time will tell, I guess. Hey, McKenny is all revved up. The Poddy Awards will be recorded next week, as this podcast right here is the last podcast interview episode of the year. And then we will record the Poddy Awards, and then I will be taking my annual hiatus. The good bros at Blood Wizard are giving away a complete skateboard. So you're going to want to probably, JV, CEO over there at the Tickety Tack World, he said, let's try it on the old Instagram. So make a post on Instagram, hashtag it, hashtag Talkin' Blood Wizard. That's hashtag Talkin' Blood Wizard on your next post. And that's all you got to do to enter. Obviously, your photo or video will weigh in heavily. So get after it. Check. I remember when the Alva boards came out with those fucking new tails, and they had kind of like that tri-concave in them. And me and my bros that were skating in the peninsula, we all gravitated towards them. We bought them pretty much for years. That was the standard. This board can ollie higher than any other board. Cooksey, Gibson, Radigy, definitely our next guest for sure. I can't overstate how stoked I am to bring you this interview. Consider it an early Christmas present. Freddie Smith, the third time's the charm. Let's go. Happy holidays, y'all.
This is Fred Smith the Third, aka the Loud One, original from Dighton, Mass, East Coast Mass Hole. And Talkin Schmit.
It's cool, like tonight is the night.
Here we go again.
Just give it the old cause turn, right here.
All big dogs in.
Schmitty.
96 times, Schmitty.
Thanks, Schmitty.
We on? Schmitty.
Talkin Schmit.
That's called going to the hospital, bitch.
I'd be shit my pants, man.
Your Rolodex is fucking deep.
It's right. About the one.
Who is this guy? Thinks he's tough shit.
What's up?
We're tastemakers.
Come on, Schmitty, what the fuck?
Let's hear it for Greg Smith. Yeah!
All right, kids, it's about to get fucking loud. Sit back and get ready for a treat. I'm honored to bring you Freddie Smith the Third, and we're about to talk some Schmit. Here we go. How you doing?
I forgot to do my hair. How you been?
I've been doing good, man. I'm just fucking trying to fucking get out of this depression dark zone that's been the last year or two, but things are getting better, I think. I hope.
Yeah, you know, it's just called weeding the herd, you know what I mean? It happens every now and then, and this probably ain't even the good one that we'll see, you know? At least it ain't like the old days, man, where as soon as you're born, you're taken out behind the barn, you know? Now at least they give you a little chance, all the snowflakes around this year, these times, you know?
Yeah, I just got married like almost 3 months ago.
Holy mackerel, man. I'm sorry to hear that.
that's what Gibson said, the exact same thing.
I'm kidding aside, man. No, I had 28 years of greatness. And, you know, through my own addiction and self-abuse you know, you hurt the ones you love, you know, and that's a terrible thing. And I didn't seem to fight that, get that back, but my children are great, lovely, and in my life still.
Fuck yeah, that's rad.
And I don't know, I mean, most people know that was Duncan's old girlfriend.
Oh, really?
No, my wife.
Oh, okay.
With Duncan, they were years and years and years.
Wow.
He dumped me off on her couch today on a road trip, and that was the beginning of it, but it wasn't the beginning of it. It's a long story. I don't know if we have time for that one. I can't wait. This is going to be great. I love, you know, it's just like being in the bar. You know, I'm sober now, but it's like being in the bar talking about the old stories, but you don't need the, you know, the coke and the fucking weed and the beer, man. It's like, it's real this time, you know?
Yeah, you'll remember it. You'll remember it.
Not bragging, we're just documenting now.
Fuck. Where are you located right now?
Right now I'm right outside of Providence.
Rhode Island.
Newport, Rhode Island for a long time. Nice little island. Had a house down there, you know, the three kids and the, you know, it was really, really nice. Good place to raise the kids, you know.
Rad.
I'm in West Warwick right now. It's just outside Providence.
Okay, and you're originally, where are you from? Where were you born? In Mass, Dighton, right?
Dighton, Massachusetts. It's like, it's pretty much in the central between Boston, Providence, and Newport, which is our good beach to go to, you know?
Where
all the Richies go.
That's where you found skateboarding and stuff? Is that where you got your first board in that town?
Not my first board, my first surfboard. I got off Sid.
Ah.
I told you that story.
Yeah, Sid's so sick.
I was a little grommet, man. Went in there. I didn't know nothing. Sid, you know, Sid has been one of my mentors, man. And, you know, and not always in a good way, obviously, but in a way. And I thank him. And I'm glad to call him my friend.
Keep the wheels greased.
What was it like truly being a third? Like, you were not a junior, you were the third. So you had your dad and your grandpa, same name, right?
Right. I never met any of my grandfathers. They were long dead before I was born.
Oh, okay.
My dad died when I was 15. So I've been bringing the name on, you know, and I don't know if I could say that I did it justice, but I'm definitely put it on the books more than them.
So what age did it all get going? Like how old were you when you got your first board, got the bug? You started surfing first, yeah?
No, we were skateboarding first. Actually, we were bicycles, man, BMX.
Ah, okay.
That was just, we lived in the country and we grew up on bicycles. You know, we didn't have a lot of money. We didn't, you know, weren't those people that, it was an old textile mill, shut down mill town, you know. We had the baseball field down the street and everybody's into sports. But that wasn't me and my boys. We were the loud ones. There was five of us.
Ah.
And we're still great friends today.
How do you
know? Because it was like free. Get on our bike, do whatever we wanted. You know, we go to the dump, get a bunch of junk bikes. And that's how I'm a mechanic and a welder also. And that was a good start on my trek towards that because we used to just build bikes.
Ah.
Just take all the old parts, girls' bikes. We didn't care, man. Until we broke them, we'd put something else together, man. As long as it was rolling, you know?
Uh-huh. When did you start skating?
I think it was around 12-ish.
12-ish.
Kmart, plastic board, open bearings. Oh, love that thing, man. That was like the, you know, as they say, the best thing since sliced bread in my world. And then we learned there was like this little entryway to a factory across the street from my house. And there was like this little granite round curb, like an entrance to a driveway that went down. And it was a long hill, about 200 yards into a giant parking lot with a river at the end. And it was just beautiful. We could skate in the parking lot. They had skatable curbs. And that little granite curb that was like a half round, you know, those ones with like a banked embankment.
Yep.
So it was like so smooth. You could just roll up, even with those trucks that were like this wide and catch grinds. And we did that all day long, like in a circle, just wow. And just that noise, man. I mean, that was like crack. We were hooked. They always say the first one's free, but watch out for the next million.
What was the crew like? How many people were in your crew? Was it a small crew?
Me and four others.
Okay.
It was me, Jeff Thompson, my best friend growing up, Paul Murray, which moved down to Virginia after we got out of school, and John Borello and Matt Murphy. And we were known as the Loud Ones.
That early?
In high school, yeah. Not that early. It was high school they named us. Because we go to parties and just destroy it. So we were known as the Loud Ones. And then everybody would say, we're having a party, but don't tell the Loud Ones. We had our inside moles.
Oh, man. What do you remember?
That would turn us on because they like seeing the damage, man. You know, it was great.
Describe one of these parties that where you guys went, Richter. Like, what was one of the, like, what's a common where you guys kicking fucking washers and dryers, throwing broken bottles, or what was going on?
That's kid stuff.
Okay.
All right. So we go to this one. His name, I even remember the name of this joker, right? Yeah. Lou Ferrier lived like right up the street, right down from where we went to school. Big ass front yard. So we pull up and Murray had a Challenger, 71 Challenger, a three or four speed. I can't remember. It was a stone crusher. 318. I think it was a beast. Stock, but man, still, even though those hot rods stock are beasts. So we go in there and he just starts doing donuts in the front lawn. I mean, like one, two, three. He fishtails out, crashes into the front steps. And just puts it in park. And he's like, we're here. Leaves the thing crashed into the stairs. So we go in. And, you know, we just take, you know, we start drinking all the booze or whatever with girls around. We put on some punk rock. We start slam dancing in the living room, jumping off the staircases, smashing stuff. And Murray decides it's a good idea to take the pictures off the wall in the living room. And I mean, this party had brownies laid out. He takes the brownies and smears big Nazi signs on the walls, on the wallpaper.
Fuck.
I mean, that's typical right there. I cooked all the food in the fridge, threw everything in the oven, blasted that, and then, of course, we hear the cop sirens coming, and it was out in the country, so we could hear them coming 10 miles away. We said, time to go, boys. We get in the car, and we drove off the other way. So it was like we were always one step ahead of them, you know? Bad behavior from the start.
Why were the swastikas so popular back then? Like,
just skate Nazis.
Yeah, where did it come from?
It had nothing to do with nothing. It was just a cool-ass design.
Okay. Yeah, it's interesting. Because it's taboo for sure.
Oh, for sure, man. And I agree. You know, I mean, we didn't know, you know, the extent of the Holocaust and all that stuff.
Right. Just ignorant punk kids going crazy, right?
Exactly. Who paid attention in history class? Come on. Did you got glasses? Did you?
Hey, I hit 40 and I got the glasses like the first month.
These are cheaters, man. I can't read a fucking menu for to save my life.
When did you meet the package?
I'm not claiming.
I was about 14. And my mom took me down there and she was like, oh, it's your birthday. We're going to get you a surfboard. Or I don't know if I pushed or she pushed. I can't remember. Down there. And I believe it was just a random coincidence of fate that I walked into that shop. And he said, this is the board you need, kid. And he'd always tell me later, he goes, dude, you walked in. I knew you had it. And I didn't know what that meant. But he obviously did.
Okay. And now, was that your first like legit board?
Yeah, it was a Hout twin fin 6'4". It was a nice board. It was swallowtail too. The only problem with those, man, those points, man, they ding up real easy because we were the only place that had good waves were rocky points, you know?
Where were you surfing? Was it in Rhode Island?
Yeah. Mostly Little Compton. This place called Warren's Point.
I was there.
It's all built up with condos now. It's hard as hell to get out there.
Is there, like, out here, there's the, you know, like, basically territorial shit where people vibe you if you're not a local and stuff. Is it the same back east?
It wasn't back then, but it sure is now because you got all the kooks from Connecticut and New York that go to school here.
Ah.
The locals, they see it as barging because, you know, they will drop in on the local when they don't know any better.
Right.
I mean, I don't know if it's just their ignorance, like you said, or young ignorant or just pompous assholes.
Yeah, I mean, you never wanted to be the guy that said back in my day. That was always my shit. Like, I never wanted to grow old and say, well, you know, back in my day. But we did. You had to pay dues to go through. And that's, I think, the mentality is like, you can't just show up here and ride great waves out of nowhere. You got to pay dues. Like, that's what it seems like to me.
Well, that's what kind of turned me off on surfing. It's almost like when you ride, like when we used to be going to have a session on the ramps, you know, we always enjoyed the large ramps, you know, the vert.
Right.
No, you get 20 or 30 kids on the platform, and it's not like the same situation where kooks aren't going to drop in because they don't get a chance. They don't know how to snake.
Right.
You know, surfing, there's really not really snaking because you can just be in the way.
Little Timmy might go in there and drown.
Be in the way. Yeah. It's fucking that's dangerous.
Right. And like snowboarding. I never really dug snowboarding. And I mean, it's sick, but you're strapped in, man. That's cheating.
Yeah, it's also like $100 a day minimum.
Exactly. And if a grandmother and a small child can be really good at it, man, there's something wrong.
On their first day.
On their first day. And if not, we'll give you lessons.
Yeah, I know. How'd you start skating vert? How'd that, like, was there a local vert ramp that, like, somebody brought you to?
No. It was just the natural old school skate progression, man. We had a small ramp, added on another piece, added on another piece. You know what I mean? That old one.
Okay.
I got a wheeler. Let's make it higher. Yeah, that was the wheel. It went there. And then eventually there was a skate park about 20, 30 minutes away. And we used to get our parents to take us there. It was cement.
kinky as all hell, but fun.
What was that one called? Do you remember?
Centrifugal Force.
Centrifugal Force.
Sea conch mass.
Mm-hmm.
Long been gone for decades, but it went down, and we still got to skate it because they just put a fence around it, and a fence to a skater is like, I don't know, putting a stop sign for a driver. I don't know, not much.
You're right. It is. How did you end up getting sponsored?
Doing road trips.
Road trips.
Dedicated, you know. I mean, and I told you I was a recovering alcoholic and addict, and I was just a very addictive personality. And that's what made me so good at I'm not saying I was good. Let me rephrase that. I wasn't that good. I was dedicated to skating in an addictive way. And if you do something long enough, determination, perseverance, and repetition mostly is you can get good at anything, I found.
Mm-hmm. If you know what you want, you can get it. You just gotta know what you want.
The whole time, man.
Right.
And you might have to suffer a little and pay the, it's like you said, pay to play.
So were you just like traveling around skating different places and then you run into somebody, or was there contests and somebody started flowing you? How was your first sponsor?
Well, I believe it was Sid.
Okay.
Yeah.
Water Brothers.
Yep. We had a crew, my crew, Loud Ones. We all skated. Then we started branching, you know, we got licenses. We'd go to we'd find ramps here and there and there. And I tell you what helped us a lot was fanzines, local fanzines that we pick up at the surf shops, skate shops. Then we'd find out about the guys in Worcester or the guys in Boston or da, da, da. And that connected us with a lot of us, our long-term friends, man, like Twister. He's out in San Diego. He's a ramp builder. You know, he was one of the original friend of ours from Worcester that we do hook up with all the time, go riding, you know, and it was that connection that was so great, you know, a family of sorts.
Were you aware of the mag right away? Like Thrasher and Skateboard Mag and stuff?
Oh yeah. The Bibles.
Who were some of the guys that you were stoked on that you'd see in the mag? Like what dudes were firing you up?
Pineapple, Salva, Martinez, Jay Smith, you know, a handful, but even Caballero, you know, I mean, he was so much ahead of us, you know what I mean? And even so, because he was so young when he started, I think he might be older than me. I'm not sure, but probably not by much.
Right. Sid had some footage of him at the Winchester Bowl that he shot in 16 millimeters. I'm when he was a little kid. It's so fucking cool.
Wow.
It's rad to have that shit.
I don't have any footage of me like that.
Did you meet Jake through the zines, through the different scenes?
No, I believe I met him when I built a ramp in my yard. And him and Gluehead.
Shout out.
And Skunky and Punky. And yeah, everybody had a nickname, you know?
Yep.
Our crew, everybody had a nickname but me. I didn't have one. I never did.
They weren't calling him Thumbhead back then?
Nah.
He's look at Felper, Thumbhead.
Felper, the Thumbhead, was doing it.
I came after. But no, it was weird because, yeah, and he was always a dick, that's for sure.
Obviously, you've never lived in this body.
I mean, I enjoyed his company, and for some reason, he was such a dick. But he was always really nice to me, and I could never figure out if he was just being sarcastic or he really did like me. I never got the straight truth on that one.
I got on video him telling me he loves me, so I held on to that one.
I'm going
to
try this for you because I love you.
I love
you. Okay, you built a vert ramp in your backyard. Was that the skate hut?
No.
That was later.
Way after.
Okay.
In my yard, I had, remember that skate park I told you about, Centrifugal Force?
Right.
We had a U-pipe on a trailer, no flat bottom, 8 feet high, no vert. So I bought that off of somebody who got it off the park. And then I bought that off him for a couple $100, trailered it to my house, took it off the trailer, sold the trailer for $200. So I was already in the clear. So then we split it apart, put 8 feet of flat, made it 4 feet wider. Yeah, 16 foot wide, added a foot of vert, pool coping in a 3 foot channel and 16 foot wide. So it was basically two tombstones with a channel.
Yeah.
It was great. It was so much fun. I learned a lot on that. And we stole all the wood for it. We'd get a truck and go up to a brand new house construction place, fill it up in night. We'd make two or three trips in one night. And I can't believe people are so dumb. They wouldn't know what's going on. Construction site with all this wood missing and a brand new ramp being built down the street. You know, yeah. Two and two together, please.
You just influence somebody.
All our wood's gone, but there's a new ramp down the street. Yeah, we weren't too smart to like go too far away. We would get the wood like in our own zone. It's like
The closer the better, we thought, you know, the less.
Yeah, exactly. Holy shit. What was your early stuff more frontside or backside? What was easier for you?
Obviously the backside's easier, but definitely tried to do both because yeah, I mean, you know, if you look at anybody that was anything, man, they were doing both.
Uh-huh.
And to just do something that's easy, that was never in my wheelhouse either. Just do the easy thing. I wanted to do the exact opposite. I wanted to do the hard part. that's the fun.
Once you get that thing that was so hard and you actually do it, it's like, yeah.
And then it's easy. It's, you know, it's just breaking the barrier, you know, and once you got it, you got it. And the ramp that I had, we had a code called the Dighton rules, where if you landed a trick, that didn't matter. You had to do it three times consecutively to own it.
Ah.
To claim it on your resume.
Hey, I did this. No, you got to do it two more times.
Yeah. And don't worry, you were called out on it. No problem.
How did you get hooked up with Alva?
That was one of those road trips. Yeah, we were there was three or four of us loaded up in my Datsun B210. That was a hell of a road trip. I think Murph was with us. We picked him up in Jersey. We got the car broke down somewhere in Delaware. I think it was like exit 11 actually. Alternator went out, but I was a mechanic before. Skating was a hobby for me.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, the alternator went out. So we stopped over the rest area and I'm like, shoot. So we asked questions. Where's the junkyard? Well, it's down here, exit, blah, 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 down the road. So we get a jump in the middle of the night, drive to this place. I mean, the battery was stone dead because it wasn't charging. So no lights. Hard to keep it running because it wasn't charging. So we can make it there. And we sleep there. It's dark. Wait for the place to open. But as soon as the sun came up, there was a freaking abandoned skate park right in front of us.
Oh, no way.
I mean, what are the odds?
Yeah.
Where we were parked. And right next door was the junkyard. So what do the stupid kids do? We skate first. Takes the car, of course. Yeah. What would a wheel skater do?
Absolutely. Damn, that's in Delaware somewhere.
I couldn't tell you the name of that place. All I know, it was a big spray painted thing on one of the half filled snake runs that said "Rat Patrol," and I'm pretty sure that wasn't the name of the park.
So, what was that trip? Where else did you guys go once the car got fixed?
Stopped in PA. We saw. KO, you know KO?
KO.
Keith Lenhor?
Mm-mm.
No, he worked for, he's in the business.
Okay.
Worked for Tracker for a long time, and I'm not sure who he works for right now. I should know. And like Dan Brown, I think we've seen there, Ray Young. I don't know if you know any of those guys.
Yeah, Brown for sure.
Brown, same area. I think it was like Harrisburg or Youngstown, somewhere around. I think it was Harrisburg.
Okay.
And out in the country, we skated his ramp, and
we actually tried to get him to go, but he had to work. And we're like, just take work off, man. No, can't do it. Mr. He was a good guy. And he texted me the other day. He goes, man, if I took off work, I might have got on Alva too.
Oh, damn.
I said, I don't know about that, but yeah. Then we were on our way to Arkansas. There was a contest down there at Payne's house. Can't remember his full name. It was in
is that Little Rock?
Little Rock, yes. I want to say Page. I can't remember, but it was a big pro contest, pro am.
Okay.
And we were there causing trouble like always, and shooting fireworks at those guys, skating, and like total moronic stuff, fighting, drinking, and partying. Yeah, it was not the skateboard way, but it was our skateboard way, which I'm not saying was right. It was just what it was.
Right.
And we TA happened to be there, and he's like, yeah, I like you, kid. And we hit it off, and that was it.
Oh, sick. So he started flowing you boards and stuff.
Took me out to California, and within a year, I had my board out.
Was that true that your first board, you weren't even pro?
None of them. I never turned pro.
But they gave you a board.
Why can't they?
Yeah, I don't know. I
told them, tell the skateboard police to come get me. It never happened. But I tell you who came and got me, my bank account.
Y'all can do the back.
Sold a fuckload of boards.
Yeah, those boards were selling more than a lot of the pros' boards.
Yeah, I did good.
Was that one of the first boards that had the longer nose? Yeah.
Yeah, and I ripped off Neil Blender.
I love Mr. Neil Blender, man.
I love that board. I love Neil. He's an awesome dude. I did some touring with him a little bit. Some unscripted touring, I would say.
Neil's so cool. Yeah, he's fuck. Package was telling me about to tell you to ask you to tell the story where you guys were buying a VCR in an alleyway by a liquor store.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, the skate park. I had the skate park there. It was in Olneyville, real squirrely part of Providence outside. And it was like back in the day, it was much more squirrely than it is now. Now you got all those hipsters moving in and cleaning it up. I guess that's everywhere. Gentrification, is that what they call it?
Yeah.
It's gross.
It's happening here, too.
Yeah. Just driving all the kids out that can't afford anything, you know. And where do they go then?
That's the question.
So, yeah, we had a nice vert session, and we might have had a few beers during the session, but we needed to go get some. And there was a liquor store around the corner, a little bit too far to walk. So we drove somebody, I think it might have been Sid's van. I don't even know. We got in, we go around the corner. It was dark and it's dingy. And this black dude gives it the old, psst, psst. Hey. I'm like, yeah, what do you want? You know, I was always looking for trouble. I didn't care what he wanted. I was into it.
Yeah.
Got a VCR for sale. And those guys had already walked around into the beer store, you know? So I'm like, all right, what do you got? You know, I was hook, line, and sinker on that thing. VCR, man, brand new in the package. So I check it out. It looked legit, man. And he goes, $60. I said, $60? There ain't no way. $20. He goes, man, I can't do that. So then we haggled a little bit. I think I got it for $25. And I was stoked, man. I was like, man, the shop needs a new VCR. We got one. We're sick. Oh, we're so happy. Get the beer, crack one in the van. We're driving back, laughing, having a good old time. We get back. I'm like, man, let's bust that VCR out. I pulled the trash bag, the black trash bag that was made for the cover, ripped that off, checked the remote control. It was actually taped to the outside, and it was a piece of cardboard taped in a square with an ad from a newspaper of a VCR glued on the top of it. It looked exactly like a remote control. But have you ever seen one on the outside of a box? It was such a piece of artwork. It was worth $25 all day long. I opened it up. It was a bunch of newspapers. It was a full pro package job. He spent at least, I didn't get ripped off, man. That story was worth $25 all day long.
We're living in a catfish age, homeboy.
Yeah. So how does the skate hut begin? What is it and how did it get going? Like it was in, where was it?
Providence.
In Providence.
It was in a place called Onlyville. It's like a little outshoot, a little west of Providence. It's like I said, it was the old mill areas where it's undesirable and run down.
Right.
And we got this huge place. It used to be a, I believe it was for repairing trolley cars. So the ceiling was like 50 feet. And it was maybe 5,000 square.
Nice.
All brick, church-style windows with all these old-school lamps that hung over, real ornate, real nice. Besides, a lot of the windows were busted out that we never fixed. You know, there was like no heat in there.
Oh, damn.
Squirrely rats.
Oh, my God.
I couldn't believe people would bring their kids and leave them there. It was like totally crazy. You had to be out of your mind.
Ah.
But I got into business when I was starting to make some money. This guy, Rob Murphy, he was a skater also.
Yeah.
And he was more of a venture driven person, you know. He owns a couple of pizza shops now and some piercing shops. Mm. But we were buddies through skating, this and that. And I gave him a little bit of loot to go in on a little park in a little pro shop. And it was like a real low down thing. And then we got the opportunity to find this guy had to get rid of a really nice vert ramp, 9 foot trannies, foot and a half of vert. And it was a really good solid ramp. So we went and took it apart and we found this place to rent. The only problem was we rented off this gangster and he was a total squirrely guy, never fixed nothing. It was all up to us to do anything to the place. And but he still wanted his rent. $2,000 back then was a lot of money.
Mm.
When you got kids that just we hardly made people pay, you know what I mean? We were like more advocates than anything. You know, we were just in it for the skating
and right
to keep the doors open, you know. And we took that ramp down, we hauled it in there, and then we started building other stuff. Like we had a real nice bowl, we had some spine ramps, little ramps, but the vert ramp was the big attraction, you know. It was a nice ramp, and we had some unbelievable sessions in there.
What year was this?
There was like 80, I'm going to say 85 or 6 to like 91, 90.
That's a good run.
Like three or four years of like hardcore. Yeah, we had all the pros come through and we had a lot of bands there. We had a bands downstairs. And funny enough was Green Day played there.
Really?
Yeah, when they had
we're gonna tickety tack out to some sponsors and we'll be right back when Fred gets his stuff hooked back up.
Head on down to your local shop. Bloodwizard Skateboards. Or visit bloodwizard.com for all your conjuring needs.
Tickety tack.
Santa all over the town, riding with Santa.
You mentioned Green Day and the whole thing went to shit.
Yeah, Green Day, I didn't even know they weren't even a band back. I mean, they were a band, but they were just touring around in their Ford station wagon. I don't even know if I went down to see them. I just, after the fact, I was like, get out of here. You know, one of those.
Crazy. What other was Gang? Did Gangrene play there? What other bands would come through?
I don't know if they ever played there. It was, we had a lot of different venues that we'd play at, and we had a band also. We turned the Loud Ones into a band back then. It wasn't a very good band, but
what did you do?
I was a bass player.
Okay.
And I still am, actually. See that thing in the back?
Oh yeah.
I still got mine.
Okay.
Is my rig kind of dark, but
oh sick, yep.
Ampeg. I got a nice Ampeg.
Okay. But,
when we were younger, you know, we were like 14, 15, like when we started skating, we started partying too, that at the same age. So we were like really hard to get booze. So we're like, we were such little crafty little buggers, you know. We're like, well, how do we do this? You know? So we start a band, cover band.
Ah.
Within a year, we were playing out at bars, getting drunk and getting chicks. It was insane.
Who and we're like covering?
Just old enough to drive.
who are you covering? What were some songs you guys were playing?
Oh God, Leonard Skinner, the Beatles, you know, the regular garb crap. And it's not garbage, you know, Stones, the staples, you know, the stuff like kooky drunk chicks like to dance to.
Just like, okay, classic rock and stuff. You weren't doing punk songs.
No.
Okay. Who are some of the locals at the skate hut?
Oh God, the list is long.
Yeah.
Oh, Kevin Day, Frank Lynn, Jake used to come, Sid, all the Newport guys, this guy Jonathan O'Donnell, he won the amateur around here 2 or 3 years in a row to go to the Nationals, you know, Crazy Horse, Twista, Car Wash, and Gunners. He took a lot of killer photos that we've been posting. And I've been talking to him online. He's like got some great photos of those days.
Sick.
Yeah. So, and let's see. I mean, we'd have people come through. We had all the Connecticut guys would come up, like Darren Mandito and. I mean, the list is so long and so heavy.
Was there anything in particular, like anything you remember, like, Hosoi came and blew it out or something crazy happened, like a gnarly session that kind of rose above it all?
No, they were all pretty above, man. We like whoever came, you know, we had Jason came.
Hi, you found me. It's hard to find me because I'm so into art. Now go away. I'm busy thinking.
We had Hosoi there.
Shout out.
Dressing.
Shout out.
There was always something going on and it was always big. You know, it was a place you went. That's why I can't believe that parents would drop their kids off there. It was like crazy. We always had these vicious dogs around, rats, you know, crackheads. Oh, man. The local, like, kid, like, white trash effect thing going on. Oh, my God. Yeah, it was pretty heavy.
You guys have a pool table or anything?
No, we didn't. No.
Just skating.
Yeah.
Sick. Is that true? I heard a rumor back then that there was like the Providence mob was after you for unpaid rent or something.
Well, it was not the mob, but a mobster. Well, like I said, man, the rent was like $2,000. And back then in the late 80s, that was a lot of money for a bunch of skate rats, you know? You know, I was making money. I could have paid it, but why would I do that, man? I was like, had better things to spend it on.
Did you go on some Alva trips? Like, did you go overseas and stuff?
Yeah. Went some great trips, man. Went all through Europe. Some crazy stories there. All through Europe, Central America, Australia, New Zealand, through the States a couple times. Yeah, it was like uncomparable to, you know, and it's funny because I, like I said, I was a mechanic. And when I got the opportunity to go on these trips, and it basically meant leaving my old life behind. You know, and for nothing, nothing's for sure, you know. And my mom was like, are you sure you want to take this chance and quit your job and leave and you don't know what's going to go on? I said, you know, this is a once in a lifetime chance that not many people get to get have, you know. And I went for it and it paid off. So I took, if you don't gamble, you can't win, you know.
Right.
If you lose, you go back and you work hard and you pick up your little feathers that got scruffled off while you, you know, you got slammed down, but it's not brain surgery. You know, if you don't try.
Where was one of the places you liked the most that you traveled to, like Australia, New Zealand, Europe?
Australia and New Zealand were great. I always like going to Texas.
Texas, like, yeah, Houston.
One of my best friends, Craig Johnson, man. We're still tight.
Okay.
He's my brother, man. Straight up brother from another mother.
Sick.
We had some crazy. I lived with him for a bit, man, and I'd always go see him. And we had some crazy ass times.
That's Houston, right?
Yeah, that's Dallas.
Oh, Dallas. John's from Houston.
Johnny's okay. In Houston.
Okay.
Johnny and Todd Prince and Ken Fillion and Troy Chasen. There's a heavy list there.
They got a good thing going down there.
Dallas has it too. You know, Phillips was a good friend of ours also. I got some great stories about John, Jeff.
What do you got?
He was a good dude. I'll give you one.
Yeah, let me hear one. I love that.
Besides his famous Fast Freddy's, which was just basically a vodka and ice, you know, blender. It was my birthday. I can't tell you the year because I don't know.
Right.
Which year it was or what year I was or how old I was. Me and Craig were in this thing where we'd go down to Mexico and we'd, we'd get scripts. You can go down there and just buy pills. So that was part of our side hustle. You know, we'd go down there, buy some pills, bring them back and sell them, you know.
Uh-huh.
We'd like to take them too, you know. And I think we were like row hips we were getting, you know what I mean? The date rape drug.
Okay, yeah.
We could take like 7 or 8 of them, and it's felt like we were ready to kill people. I mean, I don't know if they had the reverse effect or what, but so we're taking a bunch of those. I don't know, some yayo might have been involved, and drinking. And it was my birthday, and Phillips had this. It was at Phillips's house, and he lived right by the swamp, and he had a treehouse in the swamp that was 100 feet in the air. The only person that could climb up those rungs was him. He had them about 4 foot apart, so you couldn't even reach those things.
Yeah, because he was a lanky guy.
He was a big dude. So he crawled up there, and then he rigged up this harness without a rope. And I was already 2 sheets to the wind, man. I was like, they hooked me up, tied me up into this like cradle, and hoisted me up 100 feet into this fucking crow's nest. It was pathetic.
Wow.
But we were up there, we brought some beers, we're sitting there just drinking it up in the sky. It was great. So then we get down, and all of a sudden, I don't know how, but I was naked. And they're chasing me around the swamp naked, trying to beat my ass.
Oh, man.
Which most likely happened. All I remember is landing face down in the mucky water.
Oh, my goodness.
And I'm sure an ass beating came with it. But, man, I love it. Guys, they're cut of the same cloth as I am, that's for sure. I don't care what state you're from.
Yeah. Jake used to always talk about Jeff being the only guy that could do a 540 out of an invert, like invert one wall, next wall 540.
He was a beast.
Yeah,
one of the strongest skaters, him and Monty, probably the heaviest like muscle skaters I've ever seen. Just like, you don't even need to get speed, he had it. He could just whip it out of his back pocket.
Who were the Alva dudes that you like traveling with the most or hanging with? Like, were you kicking it with Eddie Radigy, Dave Duncan? Who was?
All those guys, man. It was like one thing about the team, man. There was nobody. It was like, you know, like that photo, man. It looks like a fucking gang. And we were. And if you weren't in on that, man, you were getting ousted. You weren't in on it, man. So it didn't matter who you were linked up with, man. You always had a good time.
Hell yeah.
It was great.
You spend much time with Chris Cook?
Yeah, definitely. Yep. When I lived, I stayed some time out in Southern California.
Okay. He lives in Pacifica now. Yeah, he's kind of our local guy. Like,
oh, I love Chris, man. He's a wild dude. Short and stubby, but man, he's an animal.
Yeah.
And Stevie Dredd was like, when we went out to Chicago, it was so great. He showed us around, and he was like, he's a true blue skate rat, just like we were. It was cool that he got in that photo, man.
Chicago's a good town.
Yeah. It was cold as hell, but I just heard that the one you did on him, man, that was a good one. He did everybody right on that.
Sick. Did you skate Cambridge much?
I did. The pool?
Yeah, sea pool, right?
Yeah. Yep. I got some war stories.
You got a war story. I gotta hear some good Felper something from about Jake.
Well, let's do the pool first.
Okay, I figured they'd go hand in hand because that was his spot. But sure. Well,
the locals, most of the locals there were Frank Lannon, killed that place. The Wrecker.
Is that Frank the Wrecker?
The Wrecker.
Shout out.
Yeah. And then you got your Kevin Day.
Shout out.
He was also a beast in there.
Mm-hmm.
And you had Nate, Tony, and Jake, obviously. Gluehead. Gluehead, you ever heard
of him? Fuck yeah. We went on trips with Gluey. Yeah.
Larry. Yeah. Is he still alive?
Yeah, I think he's outside of Milwaukee. Forget the name of the capital, Masson.
Oh, my God. I can't believe it.
He was taking care of. Did you ever meet the kid? He had a kid with fucking, what's his name? Damien. Little kid. He was fucking skating, and now he's older. He's working with Grindline, building parks and shit.
Shit.
Yeah.
Might even know him.
Glue. I love Gluehead. He went on the first Skate Rock trip with us, and he was kind of like Jake's technician. He would tune the guitar and make sure he was kind of the roadie, whatever.
Yeah, he was great. And when those guys showed up back in the old days, man, they were like true warriors, skate warriors. You know, we'd be all like country, rednecky, and dumb. And these guys were city rats.
Okay.
Salvation Army stuff, ripped up, shredded, skating in jack boots, loose hardware, wore out boards, man. And they did not care. And drinking too, like drinking like vodka and shit. We're like, what? You guys are sick.
Yeah,
they were big influences on me for sure.
Oh, rad. That pool looks hard to skate with the kink. I've never been there.
Yeah, it wasn't just a everyday person skate thing, man. You had to get in on that. You know, you had to put your time in. It was my duty to do that.
Right.
I never would have lived it down. You know what I mean? Who do you think you are?
When did you get into like doing tattoos and stuff? What was that, around that era, or was that later?
About the same time, yeah, about 84, 5.
84, 85.
Yeah, I got into doing tats, and then when the skating thing dropped off, and you know, I'll tell you the truth, man, and it hurts me, is that I could have extended that a long time with if I wasn't partying, you know? And that's the thing that I try and instill on these kids, man. It's like you I see kids so young and so banged up. I'm like, dude, if you stop now, you cut a lot of bullshit out.
Yeah.
You know, because like me, I didn't know what moderation meant.
Yeah, same. Yeah.
Just like skating.
Yeah, we have this that personality for whatever we do. That's what I keep saying. It's like, if it's ice cream, you eat all the ice cream in the freezer. If it's skateboarding, you're skating from dusk till dawn. If it's booze, you're drinking till there's no more booze. Like, it's just it's built within you. That's the type of MO you have.
That's what makes us good at shit.
But how do you tell kids to slow it down or stop or whatever and not be a hypocrite? And like, it's just so tough. Like, everybody kind of has to learn at their own speed. And like, I mean, you can be their influence and tell them, but like, you also don't want to be like, I don't know, I did a lot of dumb shit too. You know what I mean? Like, it's a tough one.
You're right about that, man. It is hard. And you're not going to tell somebody to do something, because how did that work out for you when your parents told you you couldn't do something?
Yeah, you want to do the opposite.
Total opposite, man. And that's just the way the human works. So what I try and do now is just, you know, instill positivity into them. You know, like, you know, don't dwell on the past. You know, they don't need to know what I did or what I did. You know, it's now.
Mm.
And just try and create, like, positivity and be nice, you know, being nice. And it isn't that difficult, really. And so much more good stuff comes out of it, you know. And you can still be gnarly and be nice. I know that's an oxymoron, but it is. That's what makes people shake their head, you know, and be like, what the heck just happened? That guy looks like he ripped my head off and he just said thank you and please and held the door for me.
Yeah, it's true. No, I know. I struggle with that shit because it's like.
And what I always say, you know, is like, if these snowflakes, I call them snowflakes, if they were around, they wouldn't make it in our time. They wouldn't have made it.
You ain't ready!
Absolutely not.
No way.
No.
And but besides that, I think it's just the fact that, I don't know, it's really hard to describe, you know. It's like, of course you're not going to get over on me. You know, I'd be nice. And that's a problem with people, man. They take kindness for weakness. And I know that's a very common thing, but it's so true, you know. And I try and help people now a lot, but I still get screwed. But I don't let it get to me, you know. I always think in my own way that I get you. Don't worry. If I don't, somebody else will. It's just karma, baby.
Yeah. And it seems to me that, like, it's important to me. It seems important to you that you just involve humor as much as you can to get through everything, right?
I operate on humor.
Oh, man. You know, you have to.
Yeah.
Taking stuff serious, all it's going to do is create anxiety and, you know, and unhappiness. And, you know, life isn't about that, man. If you think about the big scope of things, which I have been recently a lot more, is that you're here for such a short time, man. Just have fun, man, you know, and nothing's that difficult.
Right.
You know, now that I'm sober, I go to the registry. I'm having a good time. You know, how sick is that?
I mean, I don't know if you want to share, but did something in particular happen that was like a rock bottom or an incident, or did you just get tired of being the same dude for too long? Or like, what made you kind of break out of it?
You know, it's been a long road, you know, and it got to the point where, you know, me and my wife weren't doing real well, and it became a toxic environment, as they would say. And the drinking escalated, just trying to, you know, get away from that. And all that did was cause more trouble, you know, with her resentment that she can't get over, which I don't blame her, because I was very abusive, not physically, but mentally, you know. And I don't expect her to get over that, you know. I don't know if I could do that if I was in her shoes, you know.
Right.
And my kids, lovingly enough, they have forgiven me. But, you know, it got to a point where, and I'm not a suicidal person, but I look back now and it was subconsciously, I was just trying to kill myself through drinking and just bad behavior, dangerous behavior, you know, like doing stuff that I was ended up hurting myself and I wasn't looking to, I just didn't care, you know, and I was over that. I just decided one day I was supposed to go to work, and I had been sent home from work from drinking. He said, come back when you're all right. You know, so I drank the rest of that night, got a backpack full of liquor, and I'm on my bicycle at this point. I'm on my way to work, and I stopped. I didn't know where to go. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what was happening. And it wasn't like I was, it wasn't a fucked up mentally. It was like, something in my mind was telling me that something had to happen right there and then.
Mm.
So I drove to the hospital and I sat outside the door for 4 hours until they started coming out going, "Hey man, what's going on?" You know?
Yeah.
And I went in and that was the beginning of my new life. And I've been having the best time and I feel great. I feel like a kid again, you know?
Fuck yeah. That's right.
I mean, at the end there, Mike, I was seriously, I couldn't even listen to the radio. That's how bad I was.
Okay.
I couldn't enjoy a goddamn thing.
Damn.
But now it's different. I enjoy everything, man. I'm back to loving. I'm working, doing my tats, artwork, skating. You know, it's all coming back. I'm working on some new music.
Sick. So
you're about to see some more stuff coming out of me before I hit the hay, as they say it.
I like to hear that.
Before I go down.
Where, if somebody wants to get a tattoo from you, where's your shop?
I've been working out of the shop in Providence right now.
Providence?
Yeah. It's called Ronnie's. It's old school. Been there 50 years.
Shout out.
Mm.
I'll drop you some information you can throw on there or whatever.
Absolutely.
And, you know, they can get in touch with me on Instagram. Fred Smith, three with an RD. And, yeah, I'm just enjoying life now.
Eric Pupecki got his first tattoo from you. I'm sure you've given a lot of skate, you know, different people tattoos. Is there, do you remember like some of the people you've tattooed that was like,
definitely. Yeah. Tattooed Jay Adams.
Oh, sick.
Yep. Tattooed Jesse, Jason.
My bottom.
Christian Fletcher.
Shout out.
Uh huh.
Yeah, this is a bunch, man. And Pupecki, I forgot he got famous too, huh?
Yeah.
That little grommet. Don't tell him I said that. He's like 6'3", right?
Yeah, tall guy. Yeah. I put a little thing on the Instagram and got a few questions from random kids. I don't know if you know Judd Hertzler. He grew up out there and he said, "Do you remember your first session at Blues?"
My first session. Wow. Was he involved?
I don't know. He just sent that question. He was probably a little grom.
I don't remember the exact first one, but I used to love going out there, man. It was on this farm and you had to go up through this field, through a gate, and you'll go by the pigs, run down. Then there was a big rundown barn. Then you go into the woods and it was in the back over there. Man, and that thing was slippery. Oh, man.
Was that in Connecticut?
Ramp. That was a dangerous ramp. That was in Rhode Island.
Oh, Rhode Island. Okay.
Yeah.
Matt D says, "What was up with the jobless anti-workwear and where can he get some?"
Actually, you know what the funny part is right now? I'm doing some side work for my friend Jeff Seitz, Stickman, they call him. And he was jobless. He's working on something new right now.
Oh, really?
I think he's going to call it jobless, though. Maybe we can get a poll and see what name they'd like us to use.
Okay, yeah. Well, if it comes out, I think they'll get some at Deluxe SF. They'll want to carry it for sure.
Cool.
What about Fall River? You got any nostalgia about Fall River?
I was born there.
Uh-huh. You ever?
In the hospital. That's about it. I was never into heroin, so I don't know about that place.
Is it a heroin town?
Oh, it's a junkie pest.
Oh, really?
Terrible.
East Endeavors asks for your best Jason Jesse story.
Shout out.
Mm, oh, man. Got me thinking now.
I got Jason.
I know a fight was involved.
Yeah?
Yeah, he was visiting, and we were down in Newport somewhere, and I forget what the heck happened. Something happened. He just you know, that quiet Jesse, you know, boom. Next thing you know, the guy's laying down and he's just like, "What the heck happened?" And you know, Jason, he wouldn't even tell us. He's like, "Man, man, man, man." Like it was just like he asked for a drink of water. I just punched him in the face. He fell down. I don't know. You know, he's a character. He is.
Yeah, I know. He's
the best.
Good
times with him also, man. I loved hanging out with Jason.
He's a rad dude. He drove my wife's parents to our wedding. I was sick in his old car, and we had a good one.
That's so sick. Yeah, one time we went out with it was me and Jason, Alan Losey, Mark Gonzalez, and it wasn't Christian, was it? Was it Christian? Fletcher? It might have been Christian. He had a Cadillac. We drove out into the desert into this sick ramp. It was just such an oddball cluster of people. I think maybe even Blender was with us. I don't even remember, but it was like the weirdest trip. I know Losey was there. I wish I could remember that one. I'm trying to get help. I'm writing some memoirs, man. I'm trying to get some help on these stories because I'm so fried. I can't even remember them all.
Yeah, you got to fill in the blanks. I remember this and this, but
so tough. I'll be 58 real soon, and God dang it, I never thought I'd make it this far.
I didn't either. So yeah, I know. It's crazy.
You know what they say, man? If I knew I'd make it this far, I would have taken way better care of myself. Yeah, right.
Probably not. You probably would have done more. Like, if I could make it that far, fuck it.
Yeah, right.
Shit, I'm indestructible.
Did you go to some of those epic contests, like Great Desert Ramp Battle, Terror and Tahoe, some of those ones?
I never made it to those. I went to Raging Waters. That was
good one. You made it out there? I was there.
But that was after, you know, I mean, that desert one I did see in the magazine, but I was like, oh, I was drooling over that ramp. It was so wide.
Yeah, it was huge.
But didn't that have 8-foot trannies on it?
Maybe. I'm not sure.
I'm pretty sure it did. So it looked really large, but it probably was just like a super large mini ramp with vert.
Did you make it out to Lance's?
I did skate Lance's. Yep. And Fallbrook. Fallbrook was a good one.
Fallbrook, yeah, that was a classic. Was there any like parks?
Jason and Gator skated with Gator there. That was always fun. Ooh. Gator was a freak.
Yeah.
Well, he still is, I'm sure.
Yeah, he's in prison.
Yeah. Is he? I don't think he's getting out anytime soon, huh?
Nah, every time he goes for parole, they're like, nope.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a tough one.
Yeah. It was weird because he was good friends with Duncan, and my wife knew him fairly well, so I was right there, saw some weird shit.
Through that, huh? Yeah. Kind of crazy. You've seen the documentary or whatever, yeah? Stoked. Yeah, it's gnarly. What happened with the, what was it? It was Dave Duncan introduced you to your wife, you told me, yeah?
Yeah, he, I don't know, he had like this apartment up on the hills that was seriously a bedroom with a bed in it. I mean, there was barely room to walk by on one side, so obviously I ain't gonna sleep in the bed with him. There wasn't even room on the floor for a person, man. That's how small this place was.
Okay.
So he dropped me off over at her house. She lived right down there by Dog Beach, a nice little bungalow, and I was staying on her couch for, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks. And she fucking hated me. Wow. Hated me with a passion.
So it was your job to make her like you.
You know, love and hate is so goddamn close. You can't tell the difference. That's one of those cases.
Okay.
And I guess we fell madly in love, but we weren't together and we never fucked. We never did nothing on that part of it. And then I was down there living with Craig Johnson maybe a year later. And she came down to, she was friends with Craig also. Because she's from Texas, or grew up in Texas. She's from Illinois originally, Chicago area.
Okay.
But she grew up in Houston. Good friends with Johnny and Johnny's wife and all those boys.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways. Yeah, she came down to see Craig, and I had a Triumph. Craig had a Beamer, and she brought her stripper friend with her. The stripper friend jumped on Craig's bike. She jumped on my bike, and that was the end of it. At least for me and my wife. Oh my god,
that rules.
Yeah, it was a serious love story, man. It wasn't bad until just at the end when, you know, and I take all the credit for that. But what are you gonna do? All I can do is forgive myself and try and go on with life. And I've made my amends, and that's all I can do.
Yeah. Okay. Do you got something with birds?
I like birds. I've killed a lot of them.
Okay. Somebody asked.
I was a hunter as a kid, man.
Okay, because somebody asked you if you like.
We said that you know, we're weirdos. We get into shit real heavy. I was a marksman.
Oh.
Oh yeah, I had a shooting range in my basement to dial in my scope on my BB gun. Dude, if anything was moving, I was killing it.
Okay.
Terrible. I'm still living that karma off.
Okay, so you used to shoot down a lot of birds.
Yeah, and then I'd save them too. You know, if there was one fellow in the nest, I'd raise it up and then shoot it. No, just kidding. No, I've raised a bunch of crows, and a hawk, all kinds of stuff. Squirrels, possums. If we found me and my family, we were like animal lovers.
Mm.
Anything that we'd find, we'd keep and raise up until it took off.
What was one of the like best things you ever saw on a skateboard that you were there for?
As in like a trick?
Yeah, or it's just something that blew you away. I've seen really Danny Way jump off a guitar at fucking the Hard Rock Cafe.
Right. You know, that's a hard one. It's like a contest or something. That's not what skateboarding's about. I've been in some sessions that, you know, every ride is like that.
Right.
You know, I used to skate with Blaze a lot, and skating with that guy,
ooh,
man, that was a pleasure. And like, I used to like riding with Al Midget too.
Uh-huh.
And the Gutierrez boys, Graholski and Murph. And man, I mean, those East Coasters, man, we had it rough, man. We didn't have all these plush places to skate.
Yeah. So,
and even like Virginia Beach was all nice, but man, that fiberglass sucked.
What about Cedar Crest?
Cedar Crest was the best.
It was the best?
Oh, the best. Just the ramp was so solid.
Uh-huh.
And the pool coping was so rough, which was great. And just the woods and the atmosphere.
The whole vibe, everything. Yeah.
It was like a coliseum. No shit. You drive out there and you can feel the vibes like you're just about to get in a sword fight to the death with a ramp. Hey, 9 out of 10 times that fucking ramp won.
it was a solid one.
Oh my God. That thing's the closest you ever got to a cement ramp.
Okay. Well, yeah, let's hear a, didn't you have Jake's initials on one of your board graphics or something, like a JP or something?
No, actually Jake was actually on the graphic.
Oh, it was
a little headshot, a little like, I don't have any of those boards left, tell you the truth. I sold them all. I used to sell everything for gas money.
Oh, shit. You don't have one?
I think I got one in storage or something.
I hope so.
I did just get a nice one. Holly Anderson hooked me up from Santa Cruz. Or actually, it's not Santa Cruz. What is it? AWH?
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
Yeah, she's a great gal.
Rad. But yeah, it was just a drawing of his face? Or
Him. I had my buddy Thompson.
Shout out.
I had Sean McClain.
Shout out.
And Frank Lannon was on there.
Shout out.
Sick.
Yeah, man. I tell you, Frank and Jake, Kevin Day, those guys were huge, like the biggest influences in my skating probably growing up.
People send me soap.
And they weren't much older than me, but man, they were just like
more.
I'm not even going to say a generation, but like a part of a generation ahead of me. You know, and it was tough around here. Like, we didn't get to go and see all the pros and watch them at, you know, Winchester or Marina or anything like that.
Right.
So all we had was our local guys, and then we had to take it from there, you know. And it's crazy now that I all these people always say, dude, you were so influential. You know, I saw that. You were so sick. And I go, dude, what? No way. You know, and I'd never realized, you know, after all these years, that how influential that I would have been to some of these young kids and not even know it.
Everyone keeps secrets from me.
And if I did know it, maybe I would have reacted a little differently to them. And I haven't heard any real bad stories about what I've done, but usually it was pretty good. If you were into skating, I had your back. You know what I mean? No matter what.
Yeah. Okay.
This one time though, at the skate hut, this it was just like one of those things where guy leaves the freaking kid there all day. Then he's out drinking. Closing time. I'm going, I got to go, man. I got places to go. I got a girl to see or bar to hit, whatever I was doing. So I throw him outside the park and lock up and take off. Lo and behold, he's out there freaking out. It's like a crack hood, you know what I mean? And he's like a little kid. So I didn't even realize. I didn't put two and two together. Next day, the father comes in. He wants to fight, man. And I'm like, come on, let's go, man. You know, that's it. So the only thing I really had was like, you know, and it was totally ridiculous. I'm like, you know, you got to kick the bird out of the nest sometime, you know. He wasn't hearing it. We didn't throw punches, but, man, he wanted to.
Right.
It's funny because that kid right now, he's in the program, and I talked to him. He's a good friend of mine, Ryan.
Oh, cool. Funny how fucking life takes you on the loop.
Oh, it's so twisted. Yeah, it's great. I meet so many people that have come back around in my life. You know, old friend of mine, Amy, she's a great friend of mine, and she's been in my life for a while since I've gotten sober, and great friends. You know, and all my old friends have come back, and we talked to Jim Murphy, a lot of people online been talking to me, and like, you know, it's Keith Lenhart. It's just a really great thing, you know?
Yeah.
Because through my abuse of the alcohol, I was like self-secluding. Mm-hmm. And I just didn't care. And it's sad. You know, I had so much going for myself, and it's not being egotistical or anything. It's just trying to be the best person that I can be. And now I'm back to doing that.
Yeah. I mean, it's parallel with depression. It probably has part of depression involved. Like, right. You just fuck everything.
I was serious depressive, chronic depression. I got help for that. So.
When you stopped drinking, did you go straight to ice cream? Like, did you have to replace pints with pints? Just sugar highs?
Trading in pints for pints.
No, I like my candy, though. I'm a Twizzler guy.
Okay,
I like my Twizzlers. Twizzlers and coffee. I'm all set, man.
Oh, dude. I go to bed going like, can't wait to wake up and have that first sip of coffee.
Coffee is the number one drink in the world. Everybody drinks.
I drink like two pots a day. It's terrible. Especially at my age, man, I gotta stay right around bathrooms, you know what I mean? Either that or like a nice little chunk of woods right there, I can just sling one out.
That's funny. Yeah, dog.
My buddy Bruce Juice, he's a trucker, and he's a skater also. He's a legendary little local man around here. He's a great dude. He showed me the great, you know, Gatorade trick while you're driving. All you gotta do is just see you later. I mean, we were going to breakfast. He did it on the way. I'm like, what are you doing? He goes, what? He's like, so used to it. I'm like, I inherited that trick, man. I took it right off him.
You carry an empty Gatorade bottle with you in your car no matter where you go.
That's it. Just make sure the opening's big enough. That's all. Some need to be bigger than others. That's all I know.
Yeah. I've fucked with that before, too. So is the band kind of back together? Are you playing music or just by yourself?
I'm just working on some stuff right now by myself. I'm getting some guys together. I'm not even sure now if it's going to be the same guys, probably not. But I'm looking to do something a little bit different. I'm just going to put out there, it's going to be interesting.
Maybe you and the package could get together.
I already tried. He's all done.
Oh, okay.
The wife won't let him.
Nah. I want to see this documentary is coming out soon on him. It looks really cool.
Yeah, it is. I saw him not too long ago, and he said there was something stalling him. Oh, I think the guys that are making it had an actual movie to make. So he got put on the side burner for a minute.
Okay.
But it's not in the scrapyard, you know, it's just gonna be a little bit.
Yeah, a little delay. Yeah, he said the COVID kind of delayed it. It was in the works, they had to shut down for a minute. But the trailer looks super good. Like, they know what they're doing.
So good.
Yeah.
I know, I can't wait to see it.
Rad story and shit. What does skate and destroy mean to you? This is a Felper question you used to ask everybody that would come by the mag. What does skate and destroy mean to you?
Skate and destroy. Well, skate is obvious, you know? That's what we do. And the destroy part is the riddle here. to some people, it just means wrecking shit. And in turn, that is what it means, but not breaking things. Well, sometimes, but destroying is destroying the norm. You know, going up and over above what normalcy is. That's destruction to me. Destructing the common thread that people think something is. You know, it's like looking like a bad guy, but you're not a bad guy. That's destructing. Destructing a stereotype. And I think that's the best part about skating, man. There's so many different parts of it, you know. And I love that skate and destroy, man. You know, you go and when we used to go somewhere, you know, the mom would be making the kid's mom would be out there on the grill making us lemonade and hamburgers, but we'd be destroying her yard. And I'm talking about skating, of course.
Yeah.
But and sometimes the coping broke and things, but oh, they would be exuberant about that. Oh, they broke my coping. Woo-hoo-hoo. And you know, that's okay too. Hey, you know what I always say when you're in construction, you know, you got to destruct to construct.
Mm. So good. Oh man. Is there anything else that like you want to touch base on?
I don't know. I think I'm not sure what's going on with the sporting side of this skateboarding. I think that's where there's a big separation.
Uh-huh.
You know, for people to take it as a sport and it obviously has morphed into that with the, you know, with the Olympics,
right?
You know, heavy competitive,
yeah,
things going on, and then you have your underground skaters, and it's like two totally different realms.
Definitely.
And well, you know, you got your Harley bikers, and then you got your Goldwing bikers, you know, the old men with the trikes and the you know.
Yeah.
There's different things in all walks of life, and I think that's what's going on here. But, you know, and if I was to start over right now as a child and get going, I wouldn't know which way I would go. I couldn't tell anyone which way that would go. But, you know, they're doing things now that are just amazing, and that's through hard work and training. And it's just how you're brought up and where you're brought up and your lifestyle and your friends. And I guess it's just too I don't even know why I brought that up. I guess it's just too complex for me to handle.
Nah, it's just the thing I think is that it just got way popular. Like, can you believe from when you were skating in your prime to how popular it is now, where every kid has skateboards? There's Thrasher shirts on people that don't even skate that are walking through Disneyland. It's just nuts.
Yeah, that kills me.
It's so crazy.
Well, you know, you see everybody with the Harley shirts that don't have Harleys.
Yeah,
that kills me too.
Same shit, right?
Like in the old days, you know, it was like you would see somebody, and it wasn't like a turf war. It was like you saw somebody skateboarding, and you go, oh my God, there's a guy skating. You know, he's got a Minor Threat shirt. Mm. Let's go talk to him. And then you go and you bring him to the session. Either he proved himself or he didn't prove himself. And it was very easy, very simple, you know?
Right.
But nowadays, man, it's just like, you know, everybody's on their phone. No one talks to each other.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah. You know, everything's changed. World's flipped upside down.
It's so crazy. Yeah. What are some of the best bands like to get you fired up? If you were going to get in your car or if you're tattooing something, like what are you listening to get you fired up?
You know, I always loved best show I probably ever saw was Dead Kennedys.
Wow.
Oh my God.
Where was that? Back East?
That was in Providence. Yeah. You know, I always loved the old British punk, uh-huh. You know, Buzzcocks, Sex Pistols, Clash, Undertones. You know, and MC5, you got that, and you but you know, and then I got like Cro-Mags and Suicidal, and I liked all that. But
yeah, Age of Coral is so good.
Bad Brains.
Yeah, Bad Brains.
But lately, I've been so out of my head, man. I'm like, I'm listening to fucking dubstep and shit.
Really?
That's where my mind is. That's how fucked up I am.
I would never guess that.
Oh shit.
Do you find yourself with a lot of extra energy and time on your hands with this new lifestyle, or is, or what?
No, man, not extra time, because I try and keep busy, you know?
Yeah.
What I did find is, like, being sober, I have a new value for time in life.
Uh-huh.
I just try and do as much as I can, because I know I'm not here very long. So,
yep.
I mean, and it's funny, because somebody just, like, showed me a picture. They're from Cal. And a friend of mine had a drawing from when I was working in Boston of a skull and some bones or something. And he said, hey, I got it. I'm out in Seattle. Frisco, I think, Bay Area. And he goes, I'll send it to you if you want it. I go, dude, you scored that fair and square, you know? So it's cool when somebody has a piece of my art on the West Coast. And he's like, dude, you want it back? I said, no, I don't want it back. You know what I mean? And I've been trying to do a lot of painting and drawing. And I got some stuff I'm going to be starting to sell online.
Oh,
sick. You know, just for a little side hustle. And but I love art, and people appreciate that, you know? And if I can make someone's day for a couple dollars, then that's where it's at.
Right. Fuck yeah. You stay in touch with any of the guys from the old days? Like, you ever talk to Mofo or I don't know, whoever? Like,
you know, I haven't. Yeah. Thatcher,
KT,
Fitch, I haven't talked to any of those guys, but I still think about them.
Uh-huh.
And I have seen a few guys when, about 5 or 6 years ago, my band came out to play at the Juice Party in Venice. And I saw Jim Muir, Munsky. You know, did you ever meet Munsky?
No, I don't think so.
These were all like old Alva guys.
Okay.
But yeah, it was great. And I think I saw Ray Flores.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, it was really weird. I saw Jason's daughter was there, actually.
Scout?
Yeah.
No way.
I never met her before. That was cool.
Rad.
And yeah, it was just a really wild night. You know, we played right on the beach, right in their parking lot in the back. It was killer. It was so much fun. Think about somebody else I just see. You know who just got in touch with me? Wes Humpstein.
Shout out.
Oh, sick. Dogtown.
Yeah, he lives on the Cape Cod.
Oh, fuck.
So weird. Yeah, there's a couple of people that have been reaching out, and it's like so weird. I'm like, God, that's so weird.
Yeah.
And even some people that I haven't met. I met this guy like yesterday, I think. I was retrieving. I got a little side job of like collecting for people.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not, you know, it's not that way. You might take it the wrong way, but I just like, I have a good way of getting things back from people.
Ah, repo man.
Very persuasive. Guy's bike back. And then this other guy was there, and there was no trouble or nothing, but he goes, you know who I am. And he told me his name, and I go, yeah, I know who you are. And he goes, I know who you are. I know we've never met, but it was the weirdest thing ever.
Wow. Fuck.
But it was cool as shit. Just to know somebody and not know them, you know, and it was both ways on that one. It was really funny.
Yeah. Dude, you got to write your stories down. You got to fucking put out a little something. It'd be real cool.
Oh, I'm definitely. I started like 5 years ago, but then I dropped the ball and I got deep into my depression. But I had this girl that was my She worked in a, she was going to college and she wanted to do a intern, but what do they call those things? They work for free.
Yeah, intern.
Is that an intern?
Yeah.
Yeah, something like that. Internship. Where she was going to write my thing and just for the experience, you know,
Yeah, we have those at Thrasher. Right. They just want to be a part of it and they come in and they do a bunch of stuff for their resume.
Right. And when they shine, they shine.
Yeah.
And that's their chance. That's your chance.
Exactly. So,
and then I just got to get back in touch with her. She's got a ton of my stuff that she was working on. And then when I dropped it, I dropped everything. So I got to, and she's easy to find. So
good. Hell yeah.
Like I said, I got a knack on finding things. Well, I'm worse than herpes.
Oh,
I don't come back once a month, baby. I come back more than that.
Just like,
constant. Well, we always end the show with a song. You got a song you would want to play?
Puerto Rican girls, love to meet you.
Fuck yeah.
I'm going to Puerto Rico in January.
Are you?
Hook up with some friends, yeah.
Fuck yeah. Yeah, we're going to
tattoo and hang out.
Dude, nice weather. Get some salt water. Body feels good.
I might not come back.
You might not. Yeah. I know. I know the feeling. You live for that's the shit we live for. Fuck.
Hey, no taxes either.
Oh, really? Are you going to try to start doing some stuff like that, though? Like go just do like tattoos for a weekend in different locations, bounce around?
Yeah, I got a bunch of guest spots. I'm going to set up. Friends of mine have been reaching out and I've been so happy for that. And I'm grateful and I'm going to start taking them up on it. Yeah,
I got a good one for you. When you're ready, you call up and I can line this up for you if you want. But Chris Sen, him and Adam McNatt got a shop out in Hawaii. And you just go out and kick it in Hawaii and get tattooed. I don't think it's going to get much better than that.
friend of mine, Alex, has a shop out there also.
Oh, okay. Perfect.
Yep. So I could do a double hit.
Hit every island. Just do the tour.
Then I'll go pig hunting too. I hear they got a problem.
Hey, thank you so much for taking the time and connecting. This has been really cool.
No, it's my pleasure. Excellent, man. I thank you for the opportunity, and I hope you have a great afternoon and night, and as well as everyone that's listening.
All right. And in case you forget, Freddie fucking Smith, ladies and gentlemen.
Let me add in, too, that I'm pretty stoked on what Christian and Caballero are doing and Lance with the, you know, the Jesus thing. Uh-huh. And they're really like, promoting goodness. I think that's awesome.
Okay. Yeah. Anybody that you want to thank in particular that's helped you in the through your struggles or whatever, like hooking you up?
I want to thank, and you know, I hate to sound like a God guy, but my higher power. And yeah. To tell you the truth, my guy, I don't know what that is. But it did come to me, and I thank that. And whatever it was, it hit me, and it hit me hard, man, and I've seen the light. I was always on top of the game, and then I wasn't. And now it feels like I'm right back there. It's freaking awesome.
You're doing good, huh?
Oh, I'm doing so well.
That's so good.
So much good support from all my old friends have been reaching out. And, you know, it's weird because you get better. Well, I call it getting better. And, you know, there's no like, oh, you're a pussy. You know, you can't, who couldn't handle it. It's all like, good job, man. It's about time, you know? So, you know, when you're hearing those things that, you know, it is probably a good thing. And it is because I've regained almost every single thing in my life and plus more, man, everything I could ever ask for.
Well, then fuck, proof is in the pudding.
Straight up.
I was going to tell you, I don't know if you're aware of it, but in San Francisco, they built a billboard for Jake's glasses and it says still watching. It's fucking right on the freeway, like 8 blocks from my house. And tonight's the last night. I think they're taking it down tomorrow. It's surreal. Yeah, I'll send you a photo. It's insane.
Definitely do, man. And I believe I said before that, man, he was
one of my largest influences growing up, you know. And
yeah,
I don't think he was very much older than me, but man, it was a style of freshness and reckless abandon that you couldn't put a number on that, you know. It was just fucking absorbed it like a sponge.
I told a few people that know a lot of stuff about skateboarding that Jake was on your graphic, and everyone I've told, I mean, not a lot of people, but I've told a few people and nobody knew that. And they're like, really? I was like, yeah, that's true.
Yeah. If I had one here, I could tell you which corner it was in, but
do you remember how it came about? Who drew it up or whatever?
Oh, yeah, this guy, Sean McClain, he was one of the Loud Ones singers. When it became a band, he was one of the singers. And he's still skating. I believe he's out in, I think he's in Northern Cal somewhere.
Okay.
And he's still riding. And we had a little falling out here and there, but he did the graphics. And well, he was such a super duper artist,
huh.
Always had been.
Rad.
And he was up by Braintree, which is right outside of Boston. So he had hung with Jake a lot more than I had. But, you know, in certain times we were all in that, you know, being a session every week with those guys, you know. And man, I tell you, it was pretty awesome.
I just had
if you were here, I would thank him, man. You know, you said he said he told you he loved you.
I got it on video.
And you know, I'm somewhere along the line he may have said that to me. When you said that, I said, huh, because something like that comes out of a man like that's face, man, you like say huh.
And he told me that later too. Like he was very old school with a lot of his things. Like you always look a guy in the face when you shake his hand. You all, like, there was mannerisms that he really cared about. And one of the things is he's like, when I tell you I love you, you better like soak that in, because I don't just say that to any, you know. Like he would like explain to you like how important it was, you know.
That's hitting it right on the nail, man. And that's how skating was with him was like, you know.
And Glueheads in San Francisco right now.
Oh my God! And that guy also was just a huge influence, man. All those Boston guys were, because I was like a little redneck kid, you know, down south from the south of those guys.
Okay, well, who are some of the people that are helping you out, and like, you know, who do you got to give props to out there that's like really helping you get through these times?
I mean, I'm gonna have to tell you, it's not even really. He used to skate when he was a young kid, but he's a tattoo artist, and he's been my best friend through this whole thing. His name is Chad Chesko.
Shout out!
You can check him out online. Heavy tattoos. He's insane, man. He's just such a great human, you know. And he's been a life coach. He's been there for me when a lot of people weren't, and he believed in me. And man, that's something that, you know, it's priceless, man. And I'm so glad that, and I just wanted to throw props out to him and his wife, Darlene, and little Clarky, man, their kid. I mean, they're a huge part of my life, and I love him. My wife, Cindy Smith, she put up with a lot, to say the least.
And she's back?
I got to, as much as our problems we're going through, I got to give her a shout out, and my three children, little Freddie, which is, he's 6'4", not so little. We call him Little Big Fred.
He's Freddie the fourth?
Freddie the fourth, yeah.
Woo!
And my daughter, Sin Simone, and Duke. My youngest is James Duke, which is, he's a good little skater, man. He's starting to, he's getting into it.
Fuck yeah. That rules, man.
Push him, man. Anytime you push, you know, anytime you try and push somebody to do something, that ain't going to work. Just like the sobriety. You got to find it on your own. And he did that. And we've been going skating. It's been a blast. I'm psyched to see him on board.
Oh, that's super cool. Yeah. I love hearing it, dude. I mean, it's so sick when people recognize that they need to switch gears, and then they are successful switching those gears? Because there's a lot of people that want to do it, but there's not a lot of people that can do it. And so you, I think like that whole thing is just such a, like you've always been an influence in whatever you're doing, and you're doing, you're influencing people with this movement as well.
And that's what I hope to do, you know, and I'm the farthest thing from a preacher, but if I could help one person, man, I would and tell you the truth. You know, I've had a few friends call out to me and just because of this. And, you know, and all I can tell them is, you know, call me anytime and I will sit and talk with you as long as it takes, because, you know, I don't have all the answers, but I can tell you what worked for me. Right. And that's basically, you know, how you got to roll with it one day at a time.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the other shout out, I just want Tony Alva. He gave me a chance to start this whole adventure. He's the one that believed in me from get go. And although John Fowler, he didn't pay me enough for what I did for him, he kept the ball rolling, baby. And his, an old saying that he used to say, which I still use to this day. Love you like a rock, baby. I gotta go.
Fucking hell. Did you see John Gibson made it into Hall of Fame this year?
I did, man. And John's a very good friend of mine. I was super stoked for him.
Yeah.
And he fully deserved it, man. That guy is a shredder of everything.
Yeah.
I got a good little story for you real quick.
Okay, I love it.
And Johnny's turf, you know? And we're in this bar, and it's a notorious foosball bar. And if you didn't know it or not, Johnny's two brothers were like state champions. So you know what that makes Johnny? Maybe not a state champion of foosball, but still very good.
Yeah.
So these guys, they eyeball him. They go, oh, yeah, we want to play you, right? Like a vendetta thing, you know? And they go, they saw me all drunk, you know, whatever. They go, you got to play with him. We're playing doubles. And I'm just like, what? Dude, I got behind that goal, man. I was like the Iron Sheik. We totally smoked these dudes, man. You want to see some pissed off motherfuckers? Holy shit. And Gibson, dude, and I've only played a couple times in my life. So, I mean, oh, it was just perfect, you know. And Johnny, what a good cat, man. I always loved hanging with him. He's got such a great vibe and enthusiasm. You know, he's a real fun dude, and he's a good dude.
Fuck,
he's
yeah.
Always respect, that's for sure, if you're hanging with that brother.
Absolutely. Yeah. And hey, also, too, yeah,
you know, he's my brother, man. He's my brother from another mother. I love that guy too.
Good peeps.
And, we still keep in touch all the time. It's been too long since we hung out though, which we need to do soon.
Hell yeah. Also, I'm going down to visit Jason Jesse tomorrow, and he said to tell you hello and nothing but love.
Fuck yeah, man. Jason, I love Jason. He's a character, man. We always get along swell.
Yeah, he's
we can always find something to get into. Not very hard at all.
Yeah, he brings smiles always.
No doubt about that one, man. You know, when we get to the a certain pinnacle in our lives, and we've all, you know, in this business, you know, if you've done something, man, you have that little spark, you know. And you know, I've seen many skaters that are well, you know, talented enough by far to do something, but they just don't have the charisma or whatever, that little spark that it takes, that human, the humanality, you know?
Yeah.
And it's a wild ride, man. And I loved it, rode it, and now I'm back on board. So pretty psyched. And I'll definitely do some, would you be interested in me doing a little logo for you?
150%. Fuck
yeah. Be stoked. You got kids?
No, I just got married like 4 months ago.
Oh, you said that, yeah.
Yeah.
But hey, that doesn't mean nothing. Yeah. You have kids with somebody else or with her, you know?
Yeah, no, it's true. No, I don't. We're kind of.
What if your kid did that?
Oh, yeah, no, me.
That was you?
Yeah.
That was nice.
Yeah, if you got any stickers, I would love to put something up on the wall, you know.
That sounds good, man. I'll shoot you out a care package for sure. We need to hang out one day soon.
I'd be stoked. I think we're going to try to, as soon as everything is fucking, you know, we're East Coast is high on our radar.
You come out, I can be a liaison. I know everybody.
Okay. Hell yeah. Well, cool, man. Yeah. Just stay in touch, please. It's an honor for sure.
Excellent. Greg, thank you so much.
Okay, Fred. I'll talk to you soon.
All right, man. Have a great night.
Peace out.
Bye.
Happy holidays, y'all. Stay safe out there. Look for a Poddy Awards coming soon. And then feel free to email me. I'm taking some time off, but you know, I always love hearing from you. If you got guest ideas, if you got some, I don't know. I've heard a little bit about the Whack Pack rumbling, so we might have 2022. It might actually come to fruition. Anyway, I appreciate you all. Thanks for listening. Thanks for spreading the stoke. I hope you're subscribed. That'll give you any notification of any new things I do. Here's to a better 2022. Stay safe, stay healthy. Cheers.
Thank you for listening to another episode of Talking Schmit. You can subscribe to the show on iTunes, Anchor, Spotify, or anywhere you get your podcasts. When you subscribe, you'll get notifications every Tuesday of new episodes the minute they become available. Also, please leave reviews and a 5-star rating. It's the best way to help the show grow. All of the episodes will always remain free, but if you would like to help support the show, You can do so at TalkingSchmit.com, where you can pick up some merchandise like t-shirts, beanies, hats, and stickers. The website has an entire archive of all of the episodes, with extra photos and videos. Email us with any suggestions, comments, or ways that the show may have improved your life at TalkingSchmit@gmail.com. All interviews are conducted, edited, and produced by Schmitty. The intro music is Mary's Cross by the band Nature. A very special shout-out goes to the executive director, Sharal Camisa.
Shout-out.
Love it!
This is Talking Schmit, where the Rolodex is deep, but the conversation is deeper.